Morning and happy Sabbath. We're still a little sleepy this morning. Good morning and happy Sabbath. All right, amen. It's always a blessing to be in Ontario, standing in the desk in behalf of my pastor and my brother, Dario Taylor. This morning we're going to look at a subject that in many times is a subject that is misunderstood. It's not a very deep subject, I don't believe. I believe it's a very important subject, but it's not one that would require so much understanding that everyone in here couldn't really grasp it. In other words, little children and adults as well, this is something that all of us would be able to understand. Now, I know Sister Kim, she spent a lot of time on the bulletin, and I already changed the scripture. The title is going to be just augmented just a little bit. It's not just going to be the three comings of Christ. The reason why I changed the scripture is because we're not going to get to his three comings until this afternoon. So there's some preparatory work that must be done. So this morning, if you were to want the title of the sermon, it's going to be Two Thrones, Two Kingdoms, and Three Comings. All right, so we're going to deal with the two thrones and the two kingdoms this morning. So turn your Bible with me to the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 3. Matthew, the third chapter. And we want to begin in the first verse. Matthew chapter 3 and verse 1. And I believe it's very appropriate. The material, the subject matter is going to be an extension of Sabbath school. I hear you guys are studying Revelation 19. And so it's very appropriate how these things will blend together perfectly. So we're in Matthew chapter 3, and we're going to begin in verse 1 together. When you're there with me, let me hear you say amen. Amen. Matthew chapter 3, beginning with the first verse. The Bible says, "In those days came John the Baptist, preaching in the wilderness of Judea, and saying, Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And so I want you to start taking note. When John the Baptist was preaching, he said, repent for what was at hand, the kingdom of heaven. Now, what I would like you to start doing is trying to answer what kingdom was at hand. The Bible says the kingdom of heaven was at hand, but what kingdom is this? Because in Scripture, there are two kingdoms, and both belong to the Lord. So what kingdom is this? Go with me to chapter 4, Matthew chapter 4. And let's look at verse 12, Matthew chapter 4 and verse 12. You know the story of Matthew 4, Christ. He was baptized. He was led into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And we know he overcame these temptations. And during this whole time frame, John the Baptist was placed in prison. And so notice what happens in verse 12. The Bible says in Matthew 4 and verse 12, "Now when Jesus had heard that John was cast into prison, he departed into Galilee. And leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is upon the seacoast, in the borders of Zebulun and Naphtali, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea beyond Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people which sat in darkness saw great light, and to them which sat in the region and shadow of death, light has sprung up. From that time Jesus began to preach, and to say what? Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Now, what message was Christ giving? He was giving the message of John. John also preached, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Why did Jesus have to further or carry on John's message? Well, John would have been doing it, but where is John at this time? He's in prison. All right, so the message is very important. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Stay with me in Matthew. When you go through the story of the Gospels, we know that Christ, when he began alone. But then the Bible shows that he chose 12 disciples. And when he sends his 12 disciples out to do the work that Christ called them to do, what was their message? Notice what it says in Matthew chapter 10. And let's begin together in let's start in verse 1. Matthew chapter 10 and verse 1. John preached, repent, for the kingdom of heaven was at hand. Christ preached, repent, for the kingdom of heaven was at hand. Notice what it says the 12 disciples preached. The Bible says in verse 1, And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits, to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Now the names of the 12 apostles are these: the first, Simon, who was called Peter; Andrew, his brother; James, the son of Zebedee; John, his brother; Philip, so on and so forth. Jump down to verse 5. It says, "These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, Go not into the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans enter ye not, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as ye go, preach, saying, The kingdom of heaven is what? At hand." The message is the same. Christ didn't preach anything different than John, and that the disciples didn't preach anything different than Jesus. It was a systematic, complete, eye-to-eye message that they all preached. Are you with me so far? The Bible shows the burden of their message was one of repentance, because what was at hand? The kingdom of heaven, or the kingdom of God, if you were to read some variations in other gospels. As you're turning to Luke chapter 10, we're also going to start in verse 1. John, Jesus, and the 12 disciples preached the same message. When we get to Luke chapter 10, we're going to begin in verse 1. When you're there, say amen with me. Luke chapter 10 and verse 1. In Matthew chapter 10, it's the 12 disciples that preach the message. In Luke chapter 10, it's the 70 that go forth to preach the message. Now, there was something interesting. I just want to just maybe touch on it just for a little bit, trying to get your minds working. In Matthew chapter 10, Christ told the disciples not to go to the way of the Gentiles, and any of the cities of the Samaritans enter ye not, but go rather to the what? The lost sheep of the house of Israel. So let me ask you a question. What are the lost sheep of the house of Israel? Because it almost seems to indicate that the message of the disciples and the message of Christ was to a specific class of people. In other words, Israel only. But who are the lost sheep of the house of Israel? You see, because there's a mentality today that we're not to do any evangelism, that at the Sunday law, then the message goes to the world, but right now we're to focus on the church only. Have you ever heard that? You ever heard that before? But when you read Desire of Ages, the Bible and the spirit of prophecy tell you who the lost sheep of the house of Israel are. Do you remember when Christ talked to the woman at the well? Who was the woman at the well? What was she? She was a Samaritan. Now, when the spirit of prophecy and Desire of Ages is saying that he talked to the woman at the well, Christ was fulfilling what he told the disciples to go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Ellen White says, anyone who should have come under our influence, but we never saved, are the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So it's not just pinpointing the church, but anyone who we should have witnessed to and saved. So brethren, that means evangelism is something that we should do. Do you realize that the Sunday law, we're not going to go out to do evangelism then? The seed that has been sown springs up under the fertilizing showers of the latter rain. So what happens if we don't sow seed? There will be no harvest. If you're expecting people to be saved, brethren, during the loud cry, then there needs to be some preparatory work now. Amen. So the Bible says in Luke chapter 10, that's not my sermon, that was just something I saw there in Matthew. So Luke chapter 10 and verse 1, after these things the Lord appointed other what? 70 also, and sent them two and two before his face into every city and place whither he himself would come. Therefore he saith unto them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. Go your ways. Behold, I send you forth as lambs among wolves. Carry neither purse, nor script, nor shoes, and salute no man by the way. And into whatsoever house ye enter, first say, peace be to this house. And if the Son of Peace be there, your peace shall rest upon it. If not, it shall return to you again. In the same house remain, eating and drinking such things as they give, for the laborer is worthy of his hire. Go not from house to house. And into whatsoever city ye enter, and they receive you, eat such things as are set before you. heal the sick that are therein. And he said unto them, the kingdom of, and he said, and say unto them rather, verse 9, and say unto them, the kingdom of what? God is come nigh unto you. John the Baptist, Jesus, the 12 disciples, and the 70 also all preached the same message. So, brethren, do you think that message was important? Regardless of what it is, would it be important? So important that Jesus had to continue preaching it. He told his disciples to preach it, and he instructed the 70 also to preach it. Is it important then? So let me ask you, what kingdom was nigh? What kingdom was coming unto them? You see, we say it's important, but we need to know what that kingdom is. You said the kingdom was nigh. Now in our minds, when we think of the kingdom of God, many of us have the mindset of the Jews. We think of the kingdom of Christ, the second coming. This is not what Jesus was referring to. You see, they were referring to, they thought that when they were preaching, it was going to be a temporal kingdom where Christ would reign as king on the earth, delivering them from the Romans. But this is not what Jesus taught. So what kingdom was nigh unto them? This is what we want to understand. Stay in Luke with me, and I'll go to chapter 17. Go with me to chapter 17. There's a verse that's often misapplied and misunderstood. And we're going to understand this particular verse this morning in conjunction with what kingdom is being referred to by Jesus, John, and his disciples. The Bible says in Luke 17, look with me in verse 20. Luke 17 and verse 20, when you're there with me, amen. The Bible says, and when he was demanded of the Pharisees when the kingdom of God should come, he answered them and said, the kingdom of God cometh not with observation, neither shall they say, lo here, or lo there, for behold, the kingdom of God is what? Within you. Christ was trying to get them to understand, the kingdom I'm referring to is not something that you're going to see. The kingdom that I'm referring to is the kingdom that is to be established within you. And so, brethren, what kingdom is this? This is what I want you to start asking yourself this morning. Connected with this kingdom is a period of time. And so I want to show this to you in the book of Mark chapter 1. Go there with me to Mark chapter 1. And as we connect it with time, we're going to begin to be able to answer what kingdom this is. So Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1 and verse 9. And this morning, we're not going to do any preaching, but just simply extend Sabbath school. Is that all right? Amen. All right. So we're in Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1. And let's begin together in the 9th verse. Mark chapter 1 and verse 9. The Bible says, and it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized of John in Jordan. And straightway cometh up out of the water, he saw the heavens open and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. And there came a voice from heaven saying, thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And immediately the Spirit driveth him into the wilderness. And he was there in the wilderness 40 days, tempted of Satan, and was with the wild beasts, and the angels ministered unto him. Now after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying the what? The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Now when Christ and all of his disciples and John are saying the kingdom of God is nigh or the kingdom of God is at hand, does that mean the kingdom of God was there? Do you understand the question? If I'm saying something is near or something is at hand, does that mean it has come? No. It had not yet come, but it was near. It had not yet come, but it was nigh. And what called it to draw nigh? The time was fulfilled. Now, what time was Christ referring to? He was referring to the time of Daniel. Daniel what? Daniel chapter 9. Remember the story. Christ had just been baptized. But we just read in Mark chapter 1, Christ had just been baptized, and when he comes now, he's preaching the time is fulfilled. So go with me to Daniel. I agree with you. This is the book of Daniel chapter 9. This is the time that was fulfilled that Jesus was referring to. So go with me to Daniel chapter 9. Somewhere in Daniel chapter 9, the baptism of Christ is identified. So notice what it says in Daniel chapter 9. Let's begin together in verse 24. Daniel chapter 9 and verse 24. And this is an interesting thing, brethren. When you're studying Daniel chapter 9, what prophecy is Daniel 9 about? What does the time prophecy mention? The 70 weeks. And how many years is that? 490. And those 490 years, those 70 weeks, are cut off from a greater time prophecy. And what time prophecy is this 490-year period cut off from? The 2300 days. Now, the interesting thing is, both kingdoms are connected with time. The first kingdom is connected here in Daniel chapter 9. And in order to understand Daniel chapter 8, which identifies the beginning of the second kingdom that is also connected with time, you know, you have to understand Daniel 9. So in order to understand the first kingdom, we have to understand the time frame. In order to understand the second kingdom, you have to understand the time. Both are connected with time. So just keep this in mind as we build this morning. The Bible says in verse 24, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, and to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem, unto who? The Messiah, the Prince, shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again, and the wall even in troublous times. Now, we're all familiar with this prophecy. Who is the Messiah, the Prince? Christ. What does the word Messiah mean? All right, if you go to the book of John chapter 1, matter of fact, turn with me to John chapter 1. All right, there might be some who've never studied these things, so I'm not going to assume. Go with me to John chapter 1. John chapter 1, let's look together in let's start in verse 40. John chapter 1 and verse 40. This is when Christ is calling his disciples. And the Bible says in John chapter 1 and verse 40, when you're there with me, amen. It says, one of the two which heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first findeth his own brother Simon and saith unto him, we have found the what? The Messiah, which is being interpreted the what? The Christ. If you have a margin in your Bible, what does Messiah or the Christ mean? It means the anointed one. And Acts chapter 10, verse 38 tells us that Christ was anointed with the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost and with power. And we know that the Holy Spirit came upon him in power at his baptism. So when the Bible says in Daniel chapter 9 and verse 25, when it says that unto Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks, or 69 weeks. When Christ was baptized in 27 AD, this was the fulfillment of the 69 weeks. The time was fulfilled. So when he came preaching, saying the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand, the kingdom of God is connected with his baptism. Are you all with me so far? Amen. All right. In order to establish the kingdom of God, Christ had to be baptized. So keep this in your mind. Now flip with me. Stay in John. I tell you what, stay in John and let's go to verse 29. Let's look together in verse 29. Stay in John and let's look in verse 29. John chapter 1 and verse 29. We identify the baptism of Jesus. This is when he now comes saying the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is nigh or is at hand. Notice what the Bible says in John chapter 1 and verse 29. The Bible says, the next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith what? Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, after me cometh a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me. And I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water. And John bare record saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. And I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizeth with the Holy Ghost. And I saw and bare record that this is the Son of God. Again, the next day after John stood and two of his disciples, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, he saith, behold the what? The Lamb of God. Now, when you're thinking of the Lamb of God, what does this take the mind of a Hebrew and Israelite to? To the sacrifice. The Bible says he was the Lamb of God that would take away the what? Sin of the world. Now, if you go back to the sanctuary service, brethren, this is very simple this morning. If you go back to the sanctuary service, could sin be atoned for or forgiven if the lamb was not slain? No. Without the shedding of blood is what? No remission of sins. So when John had baptized Jesus and John identified Christ as the Lamb of God that would take away the sins of the world, John wasn't looking at him at that moment. John was seeing what he was going to accomplish. Are you with me? In other words, the time was fulfilled. The kingdom of God was nigh at hand. John understood it and took your mind to when it would be established. And that's when Jesus becomes the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. As a matter of fact, go back with me to the book of Daniel. Go back with me to Daniel chapter 9. Let's finish off that prophecy. Daniel 9, we read verse 24 and 25. Let's read verse 26 and 27. So we're in the book of Daniel. We're in chapter 9, verse 26 and 27. The Bible says, and after 62 weeks shall Messiah be what? Cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolations are determined. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. And in the midst of the week, he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease. And for the overspreading of abominations, he shall make it desolate, even until the consummation. And that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. It's very interesting. I don't want to lay down too many layers, but I will tell you this. There are two kingdoms that God establishes, and with the devil, it's the same thing. And that's why when you're reading through the prophecy of Daniel 9, it gives you what Christ is going to do to establish his kingdom and also what the devil is doing to establish his kingdom. Did you ever wonder why the verses are blended that way? Why it starts with Jesus and then it deals with this mystery of iniquity? While you're reading verse 26, it's talking about Messiah being cut off, but not for himself. And then it gets into the people of the prince that would come, that would destroy the city and the sanctuary, speaking of Rome. Why does the Bible do that? It's because it's dealing with the establishment of the two kingdoms. The two kingdoms under the mystery of godliness and the two kingdoms under the mystery of iniquity. This morning, we're just dealing with the mystery of godliness. So the Bible shows, behold the Lamb of God. He's baptized. He's identified as being the Lamb that will be slain in behalf of the sins of men. And the Bible tells you here in verse 26 and 27 that Messiah that was established at his baptism would be cut off. Now, what does it mean to be cut off? The Bible tells us it means to be killed. In Isaiah 53 and verse 8, it says he was cut off from the land of the living. All right, so we know that this is referring to the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. So in order to establish this kingdom, mark this now. In order to establish the kingdom that John preached about and that Christ preached about and that his disciples preached about and that the 70 also preached about, there were prerequisites that were necessary. There needed to be the birth of Christ, the baptism of Christ, and the death of Christ. These were necessary in order to establish this kingdom. So again, this kingdom, brethren, is not a kingdom that comes with observation. You're not going to see it. Why? Because it's where? It's in you, John says, or Luke says. So what is this kingdom? All right, let's continue to study together. So go with me back to the book of John. Go with me back to the book of John. I hope this morning that at least your wheels are turning. We want to identify what this kingdom is. So we're in John chapter 19. In order to establish this kingdom, There had to be the life or birth of Christ, his life, his baptism, and his death. And of course, all of that includes his ministry. So notice what your Bible says in John chapter 19. Christ is identified as the Lamb of God, identifying his death. So let's go to the time where Jesus dies. So go with me to John, we're in 19. And let's look together in verse 30. John chapter 19 and verse 30. And when you're there, amen. The Bible says, when Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, and this of course is when he's on the cross, it says, he said, it is what? It is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. So we know this is when Christ dies. Amen? Now, when he dies, or before he dies, what does he say? He says, it is finished. Now, I'm going to ask you this question. When Christ was on earth, what role did he play? When he's in heaven now, correct? What is he doing for us in heaven now? He's what we call our high priest. Was he high priest on earth? No. What was he on earth? All right. He had to become the Lamb. All right. Well, he wasn't a priest yet. All right. A messenger. He was called a prophet. Do you remember when Moses says that there will be another prophet that is to come that's likened unto me? Moses was referring to Christ. And this is why all of the Hebrews were looking forward to that prophet. And when John came preaching, the Pharisees said unto him, who are you? Are you Elijah? And he said, no, I'm not Elijah. Are you that prophet? He says, no, I'm not that prophet. I'm the voice that's crying in the wilderness, referring to Isaiah chapter 40. And so Christ was prophet on earth. When his role as prophet came to an end, it came to an end by the way of three words. It is what? Finished. And this now takes him into the beginning of his other role. All right? So, it is finished. What was done? What was finished? What did Christ finish on the cross? A lot of questions I'm asking you, but it's all going to come together. All right? What was finished? All right, let's stay in John. Go with me to John chapter 4. That's actually a very broad question. It's very broad. But notice what it says in John chapter 4. Let's try to narrow it down a little bit. Christ is on the cross. As a matter of fact, when you read John chapter 19, before he says it is finished, the Bible says that he had realized that all things were now done. Everything that he came to do was done. And so he was able to say it is finished, and he gave up the ghost. So what did he come to do? Notice what it says in John chapter 4 and verse 34. We don't mind a Bible study this morning, do we? All right, John chapter 4. Let's look at verse 34. He says, it is finished. What was finished? Look at verse 34 with me when you're there. Amen. The Bible says, Jesus saith unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to what? Finish his work. So when Christ says it is finished, what was finished? His work. The work of who? The work that the Father had sent him to do. So what was the work that the Father specifically sent forth Christ to accomplish? Go with me to your Bibles to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah 53. Go with me there. Isaiah 53. What was the work that the Father specifically sent forth the Son to accomplish? Isaiah 53. And let's begin together in verse. Let's just go ahead and jump down to verse 3. Isaiah 53 and verse 3. We're familiar enough with Isaiah 53 to understand this is referring to Christ. Notice what it says in verse 3. Isaiah 53 and verse 3. It says, he is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of what? us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he hath done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. It says, yet it pleased who? It pleased the Lord to bruise him. Now, who is the him that's being referred to here? Christ. It pleased the Lord to what? To bruise him. Don't forget that, brethren, because that's the very first promise and prophecy of the Bible. That's Genesis 3:15. I will place iniquity between you and the woman, between her seed and thy seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shall bruise his what? His heel. And it pleased the Lord, it pleased God to bruise him. Why? It says, he hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressor. The Bible tells us very clear that Christ became the man of sorrows. Christ was acquainted with grief. Christ was bruised. Christ was smitten. Christ was afflicted. Christ received stripes. Christ went to the cross, all because it pleased the Lord. This was God's desire. This was God's work. So when Christ says, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work, when it came to the cross, and it says, all things were now accomplished, he says, it is finished. And he gave up the ghost. The work that God desired the Son to do is to become the Lamb of God that would take away the sins of the world. Are you with me? Now, brethren, John preached about the kingdom that was to come. Christ, the disciples, all of them preached it. Christ went a step further and connected it with time. He said the time was fulfilled. What time? The time of the 69 weeks of Daniel chapter 9, the time that identified him as Messiah, the anointed one, the one who was to yield his life as the Lamb of God. And because all of these things were now being put in place, the kingdom of God was nigh at hand. So again, what is this kingdom? Well, before we answer that specifically, go with me to Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. Let's look a little bit further at the work or the meat that God had given Christ to fulfill. Notice what it says in Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5 and verse 6. Romans chapter 5 and verse 6. You know, the interesting thing, brethren, is the first kingdom was not necessary. As we're going through this, brethren, you're going to see the first kingdom in reality was not necessary. The first kingdom, it enters in because of sin, but it was not necessary. It was planned for. Sin and the sacrifice for sin was not an afterthought, but the first kingdom was not necessary. If Adam and Eve had not sinned, we would have went straight to the second kingdom. But because of sin, the first kingdom has to enter in. And it's the kingdom that is without observation. The second kingdom, you can see it. The second kingdom, God himself is there. But the first kingdom, brethren, it's within you. And unless there was no sin, or if there was no sin, there wouldn't be no need for this second kingdom, or the first kingdom, rather. So notice the work that God sent Christ to do, and it's connected with his kingdom. Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. And let's look together in verse 6. Romans chapter 5 and verse 6. And when you're there with me, amen. The Bible says, "For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die. Yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commendeth his love towards us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin," who was the one man that brought sin upon the earth? Adam. "And so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed where there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigneth from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come. But not as the offense, so also is the free gift. For if through the offense of one many be dead, much more the what of God? The grace of God, and the gift by what? Grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, hath abounded unto many. And not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift. For the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive the abundance of what? Grace, and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as by the offense of one judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so by the righteousness of one the free gift came on all men unto justification of life. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. But where sin abounded, what? Grace did much more abound. That as sin hath reigned unto death, even so might what? Grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. The Bible says very clearly that the work that Christ came to do was to reverse the curse that Adam brought. Because of one man's sin, death came upon all men, so by the obedience of one, life and grace can be given to all men. The meat that Christ came to do, the work that Christ came to do, the work that he was to establish and finish for the Father, was the establishment of grace. And the Bible says that grace was to reign by one. And when you look at that word reign, brethren, what does that word mean? It's not R-A-I-N. The word reign is connected with a what? A kingdom. Christ said the kingdom of God was nigh. John said the kingdom of God was at hand. The disciples said it. The 70 said it. What kingdom was to be established because of the life, the baptism, and the death of Christ? It's the kingdom of grace. This is the first kingdom, and it was never necessary until sin. Not until sin did grace have to abound. Now, brethren, when you start thinking about these things later on in your minds, I believe it will blow you away like it did me. I want you to look with me in Romans chapter 5 again. Romans chapter 5. And look with me in verse 6 again. We read this verse, but I want you to look at it again. The Bible says in Romans chapter 5 and verse 6, when you're there, amen. It says, "For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly." What does that mean, in due time? If you have a margin in your Bible, what does due time mean? According to the time. What time? The prophecy of what? Daniel chapter 9 again. Daniel chapter 9 establishes the kingdom of grace. It identifies his baptism. It identifies his death. It identifies what Christ came to establish, how he was going to say it is finished, how he was going to establish and fulfill and complete the work that God had called him to do. The Bible says, in due time or according to the time, Christ died for the ungodly. Wasn't Christ's death, his crucifixion, wasn't it based upon time? Yes, in the midst of the week, he would cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease. We know that's 31 AD. Now, go with me to Acts chapter 1. Go with me to Acts chapter 1. Let's just kind of walk through this story and see how this kingdom is being established. And indeed, we'll see that it is the kingdom of grace. There are two kingdoms. One is the kingdom of grace, and the other is the kingdom of glory. The Jews did not understand the kingdom of grace. They wanted Christ to establish the kingdom of glory, but that was because they didn't understand the nature of sin nor the work that he came to establish. They had the prophecies, they read them every Sabbath, but misapplied them. Brethren, I tend to believe that many of us do the same thing. We want to bypass the kingdom of grace and go straight to the kingdom of glory. And what prepares us for the reception of the kingdom of glory is the latter rain. What prepared God's people for the reception of the kingdom of grace? Notice what it says in Acts chapter 1. Go with me, Acts chapter 1. And let's begin together in verse 1. Acts chapter 1 and verse 1. Amen when you're there. The Bible says, "The former treatise have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up. After that, he, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandment unto his apostles, whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion, by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the what? The kingdom of God." What kingdom? It's the kingdom of grace. It says, "And being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, will thou at this time restore again the what? Kingdom to Israel." Even now they don't understand. Why do you think Jesus... Well, I mean, there's prophetic answers too. But why did Jesus have to spend 40 days with them before his ascension? Why 40 days? Well, he's fulfilling prophecy, okay, because he had to be there 40 days. He told them to go into the upper room. They were there for 10 days. Then comes the day of Pentecost. It was fulfilling the types of the Old Testament. But why did he have to spend 40 days with them? The Bible said when he was spending that time with them, he had to teach them the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. They didn't understand the kingdom of grace. He had been trying to teach them for 3.5 years, and they didn't understand it. There were things in their mind, misconceived ideas and opinions, that kept them from identifying the fullness of the time, that kept them from identifying his work and what he was coming to do. So for 40 days, he's giving them Bible studies on the kingdom of God. And the Bible says that even at that time, they say, "Well, are you now going to establish the kingdom of Israel?" And so Christ has to say to them in verse 7, "And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons, which the Father hath put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you." It says, "And ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth." And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was what? Taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. So Christ is now taken up from the earth. All through his ministry, he was teaching them a single theme, the kingdom of God. I want you to keep this in your mind. From the beginning of his ministry to the end, it was about the kingdom of God. And this kingdom we're going to see is the kingdom of grace. This was the meat, this was the work, the labor that God sent his son forth to fulfill. At the cross, Christ was able to say, it is what? It is finished. And when he said it is finished, the kingdom of grace now goes into effect. Now you have to understand, grace was given at first when man sinned. Are you following me? The moment man sinned, grace was extended. But it was not yet fully established. All it was given by promises. But now Christ dies and the kingdom is firm. It's established. From that point all the way back to Adam, it was based upon promise. Now it's here. And that's why when Jesus preached, he says, it is nigh at hand. Grace had been along all around, but now it was established. If Jesus never died, think about it. Do you know up to this point, before Jesus said it was finished, he could have came down off the cross? You ever read Desire of Ages? He could have came off that cross before he gave up the ghost. And what would have happened? All the individuals that had looked forward to him being the Lamb of God by faith, all of their sins that the Bible shows were forgiven would have been heaped back upon them. Individuals such as Enoch and Moses and Elijah, who were in heaven based upon grace, would have had to come down and die. Moses would have had to die again. So, brethren, we have to understand all through that time, for 4,000 years of time, it was all grace based upon promise. But now it was firm. Are you with me? And so the Bible says that he was teaching his people. He was received up into heaven. Now, when he was received up into heaven, where did he go? This is how we're going to establish the kingdom of grace. I want you to notice what it says in the book of Mark. Mark chapter 16. Mark chapter 16. Mark the 16th chapter. Mark chapter 16 and verse 19. And we're not going to necessarily delve into it, but I will say this to you. When you read Acts chapter 1, and he's telling the disciples to wait for the promise of the Father, what was the promise of the Father they were to wait for? What was the promise? That they would be baptized with the Holy Ghost and with what? With fire. And that's why you have the cloven tongues of fire that ended up being upon their head that Christ cast down in Revelation chapter 8. When you read Revelation chapter 8 and he has that censer and he takes the coals from off the altar and he puts it in the censer and casts the fire into the earth. All right, this is the reception of the Holy Spirit. This is Pentecost. All right, so Pentecost was the promise of the Father. But what was Pentecost for the believers? When you read in Desire of Ages, we're told that Pentecost was the promise that his inauguration had been completed. All right, he was now established as what? Melchizedek. And what is Melchizedek? But what is Melchizedek? Is he just a priest? Oh, he's also a king. We're talking about the kingdom of grace. He is established now as king, and the early reign was an indication that it was completed. So with the first kingdom, the kingdom of grace, the early reign is a sign that that kingdom had come. So when we come to the second kingdom, the kingdom of glory, the latter reign and the reception of the latter reign is that that kingdom is about to be established as well. So brethren, when we come to the time of the latter reign, you know that the second phase is about to be initiated. The kingdom of glory is right upon us. And that kingdom is with observation. Every eye shall see him. The Bible says in the book of Mark 16, Mark 16, look with me in verse 19. Mark chapter 16, verse 19, when you're with me, amen. Amen. The Bible says, so then after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven. Remember, this is what we read about in Acts chapter 1. After he had spoken to them, he was received up into heaven and sat where? On the right hand of God. Now we want to find out, what is he doing at the right hand? All right, go with me to Hebrews. Go with me to Hebrews. Now we'll review everything we've talked about. It's really just a simple theme. It's a simple story. But there's many different things that you can deal with this simple theme. Go with me to Hebrews chapter 12. When Christ ascends to heaven, he was taken out of the sight of the disciples. The Bible says, Mark says, that he sat at the right hand of God. Notice Hebrews 12. Hebrews chapter 12, let's look at verse 2 together. Hebrews chapter 12, and what verse are we going to? Verse 2, the Bible says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the what? The throne of God. So keep this in mind. Mark says he went to the right hand of God. Paul in Hebrews says he goes to the right hand, but he goes to the right hand of the throne of who? Of God. So when Christ ascended into heaven, 31 AD, whose throne did he go to? God the Father's throne. All right, the one that you see in Revelation chapter 4 and 5, the one who is sitting on the throne, this is where Christ now ascends to, and he's sitting at the right hand of the throne of God. Go with me to the book of Psalms. Go with me to Psalms. All right, we're starting to just bring out final thoughts, and we'll continue on this afternoon. But notice what it says in Psalms 110. Psalm 110. And because we're all very familiar with the story of the gospel and the story of Christ and what he has done for us, we're just following that theme and we're just bringing out why he went through what he went through. The Bible shows that he and John and the disciples preached a singular message that encompassed much, but the message was simple: the kingdom of God is at hand. And what establishes the kingdom of God? Christ told you. He said the time was fulfilled. That takes you to Daniel 9. And Daniel 9 shows you the time is based upon when Christ would be baptized. But then it also identifies the time when he would what? He would die. And Paul tells you that it was in due time, or according to time, that Christ died for the ungodly. Paul takes you also back to Daniel chapter 9. When Jesus was saying the time was fulfilled, he was referring to Daniel chapter 9, verse 25. That was the message of the disciples. But when Paul was preaching, the baptism, you know, that was good, but Paul is talking about the death of Christ. And so he also talked about the time being fulfilled, or according to the time. And all of it was to fulfill or finish God's work. And what was God's work that he gave Christ to do? The reconciliation between God and man. The sacrifice for sin, the issuing in of the reign of grace. All right, this is what Paul talks about. So the Bible shows that Christ, he dies, he resurrects, he speaks to the disciples for 40 days. And what was he teaching them for 40 days? All about the kingdom of God. Did they understand everything? No, because even at the end of 40 days, they said, are you now going to establish the kingdom in Israel? Christ is like, man, you know, it's not for you to know these things. All right. So you just wait until the promise of the Father comes. And we know that when the promise of the Father came in Acts chapter 1 and chapter 2, what happened to the disciples? Their minds begin to understand things that were formerly dark to them. Peter stands up and says, men and brethren, wait a minute. This needed to be fulfilled. And he started going through the prophecies. And so now they're starting to understand a little bit about the kingdom that Christ came to establish. Well, now Christ is at the right hand. He's ascended. He's at the right hand of God, but the right hand of the what of God? The throne of God. Now notice what it says in Psalms 110. Psalm 110, beginning with verse 1. And we'll just skip from verse 1 to verse 4 for time. It says, the Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou at my right hand until I make thy enemies thy what? Footstool. Now, when David is saying, the Lord said unto my Lord. Okay, now is David referred to as one of the lords there? No. Who is David's Lord? Christ. So who is the Lord that's saying to David's Lord? All right, this is the Father speaking to the Son. And the Father says to the Son, sit at my what? Right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. So Christ had to sit in his Father's throne until Christ's enemies were made his what? Footstool. Does that identify that Christ will always be there? No, there will come a point in time where the time again will be fulfilled and it's going to now bring in the other kingdom. All right, not the kingdom of grace, but we'll see the kingdom of glory. So it says in Psalms 110, sit thou at my right hand till I make thy enemies thy footstool. Verse 4, while he's sitting at Christ's right hand, what is he? The Bible says, the Lord hath sworn and will not repent. Thou art a priest forever after the order of who? Melchizedek. Now, when you look at Melchizedek, Melchizedek was a priest king. All right, he was the king of Salem, but he was also the high priest. So he was a priest king. He had a dual role. Christ, he now is sitting upon the throne with God, and he's doing the work of priest, but it's after the order of Melchizedek, so he is also reigning as what? As king, but it's based on expectancy. In other words, you're going to sit here, and you're going to be Melchizedek. Now, when the Bible says, sit at my right hand, please don't believe that all Christ is doing for these long years is just sitting down. When the Bible says, sit at my right hand, being at the right hand of the king is the highest position next to the king himself. All right, the one who is on the right hand of the king is in the highest position next to the king himself. So the Father who is on his throne is the top dog. Are you with me? Christ is at his right hand in his Father's throne, doing the work of intercession as priest. But he is also Melchizedek, so he is also king, but he doesn't have his own throne yet. So he's not reigning as king. So he's doing the work of priest. Say amen if you're with me with that. Okay. So notice in your Bible, back in the book of Hebrews. Go with me back to Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 8. Hebrews chapter 8. And if in reality, if you're really following what I'm saying, this clears up a whole lot of misconceptions that even Adventism has regarding the role of Christ and what Christ came to do, what he's doing now, what role he's playing in heaven, so on and so forth. Because many of us believe, if we're honest, that Christ is our judge. And that's unbiblical. It's unbiblical. You won't be able to find that in the Bible. The Bible tells me in Daniel chapter 7 that the books are open before the Ancient of Days, and one like unto the Son of Man comes before him. The Ancient of Days is the one who was our judge. But the judgment comes in two phases. First, the investigative judgment, and then the what? Executive judgment. And because there's two phases in the judgment, they actually correspond with the two kingdoms, but we're not there yet. All right, so notice what it says in Hebrews. Notice what your Bible says in Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 1. Hebrews chapter 8, what verse? Verse 1. The Bible says, now of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such an high priest who is set at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle which the Lord pitched and not man. So we know this is referring to who? Who is this high, great high priest who's the minister of the sanctuary? We know this is Christ. All right, we know he is reigning or he is in the high priestly state as Melchizedek. Now, Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4. Stay in Hebrews. Just go with me to chapter 4. In this particular verse, we can identify the kingdom. All right, we've already said what kingdom it is, but let's identify it. So the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4, beginning with verse 14. Hebrews chapter 4, what verse? 14. Are you with me? The Bible says, seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. Now, when the Bible said he was passed into the heavens, it says he sat at the what? Right hand of the throne of God. And he's there doing the work of Melchizedek or as high priest. It says, for we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the what? Throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Brethren, when the Bible identifies a throne identifies a kingdom. This is the throne of what? grace. So this kingdom is the kingdom of what? Grace. There are two thrones. There are two kingdoms. The first throne is the throne of grace. This is where the Father sits. This is where the Father sits. And it's upon the throne of grace. And this is also beautiful if you're afraid of the judgment. Because on the throne of grace is where the Father is now going over the books. So mercy and justice, brethren, they're meeting with one another. They're kissing one another. The throne that we have to come before is the throne of grace. And we don't have to wait until judgment. We can go before that throne now to find grace to help us in time of need. And when is our time of need? Whenever we're tempted to sin. So grace and the kingdom of grace was established so that you and I can overcome. This was Genesis 3:15's promise. This is what all the prophets spoke about. This is what angels desired to look into. This is what Christ came to ratify. And when he says it is finished, it went into effect. It's done. The promises are now fulfilled. And you and I, we don't have to, like the Jews of old, look forward to promise. We look back to a completed work. He established grace. Not the atonement complete, but the sacrifice for sin was accomplished. So the throne of grace, which identifies a kingdom of grace. And just in case we're saying, well, what do you mean there's two thrones? Let's go to our scripture reading in Revelation chapter 3 and verse 21. Let's go to our scripture reading. We'll see very clear that there are two thrones. Notice what your Bible says. A few more Bible texts, and I want to read something in the spirit of prophecy with you, and then we'll close. Notice what scripture says in Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3, let's look together in verse 21. Revelation chapter 3 and verse 21, and when you're there, amen. Are there two thrones? What does the Bible say? To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in what? My throne. Who's talking here? Christ. He says, if you overcome, you're going to sit with me in what? My throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in what? His throne. Jesus has a throne, but he's not on it yet, because that identifies another kingdom. But the Father is on his throne, and Jesus is reigning with Christ, Christ is reigning with the Father on his throne. You and I get to reign with Christ on his own throne if we overcome like Christ overcame. If you and I follow the footsteps of our Master. And brethren, think about it now. What was Christ's work? What was his footsteps that we are to follow? What did John and Jesus and the apostles, the 12 and the 70, what did they come to establish? Kingdom of what? Kingdom of grace. Their message was one of grace. Their message was one that people's sins can be forgiven. Their message was one that pointed out that, behold, the Lamb of God. So if you and I are going to reign with Christ in his throne and overcome like Christ overcame, walking in the footsteps of our Master, our message, what will our message be? Our message would also point people to the Lamb of God. Our message would also be one of grace. Now you might say, well, wait a minute. I thought our message was the first and the second and the third angel. Well, that's correct. But when you look at the first, second, and third angel, we're told that's the last message of mercy. It's the message of grace that's given to an undying or given to a dying world. So brethren, rightly understood, the first, second, and third angel's message is the abundance of grace. But it has to be presented that way. You know, you can catch more flies with honey than vinegar. You ever heard that before? Brethren, we need to present Christ to people. People need to understand Jesus. If you were with us at camp meeting, there was one thing that we all realized while there, when we were at the 2020 Vision camp meeting. And there was a theme there. There was something that we saw there at the camp meeting. And it kind of like reminds me, and I preached about this while there, when you look in the book of Matthew chapter 17, And you go to Matthew 17, we know this is the Mount of Transfiguration. And while Christ is being transfigured before Peter, James, and John, Peter, James, and John saw Moses and Elijah with Jesus, right? And we briefly touched on it because the point was something else, but you can show that Moses and Elijah. Now I had to ask the question at camp, why Moses and why Elijah? Why not Enoch? Enoch was taken to heaven as well. Why not Moses and Enoch? Why did it have to be Elijah? Because Moses and Elijah are used typically in the Bible to identify the law and the prophets, the Old and the New Testament, or the Word of God, the Bible, the Spirit of prophecy. Moses, Elijah, and Jesus, when you take the themes of their life, you can show one represents the first, one represents the second, and the other represents the third angel. So when transfiguration took place, they saw the first, second, and third angel's message in its fullness, in its clearness. But then the Bible shows that they heard a voice from heaven, another voice that spake. All right, this is kind of like what you read about in Revelation 18 with the fourth angel. And when this voice spoke, the Bible shows it made them quake and they fell upon their face. And when their vision cleared, they had seen the first, second, and third angel, Moses, Elijah, Jesus. They had heard the other voice speak. They had heard the fourth angel. It caused them to fall upon their face. Much like all of the prophets, when they actually see the vision, they have an experience where their comeliness is turned into corruption. But when their vision cleared, the Bible says they saw nothing but Jesus only. And when you read what it says in Acts of the Apostles, Jesus only was the theme and power of the early church. And brethren, we're told that we are to experience again a revival of apostolic godliness that has not been seen since apostolic times, or primitive godliness, she says. In order to establish their primitive godliness, they saw Jesus only. So in order for that to happen again, what do we need to see? Jesus only. Our vision must be clear. And Jesus is seen in all of the things on the charts. Jesus is seen in every date, in every beast, in every timeline. Christ is there, but we have to labor to see him only. This is the message. And so the Bible says in Revelation chapter 3 that there are two thrones. Christ is reigning with his Father on the Father's throne, and the Father's throne is called the throne of grace. And the throne of grace identifies the kingdom of grace. That's the first kingdom, and that's the first throne. But when Jesus comes the second time, notice what it says in Matthew 25. Matthew 25. Look with me in verse 31. Matthew 25 and verse 31. Matthew 25 and verse 31. We'll look at this and one other Bible text, and then we'll read a spirit of prophecy statement and close. Matthew 25, verse 31. When you're there, amen. The Bible says, when the Son of Man shall come in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of what? His glory. Whose throne is Christ sitting on at the second coming? Is it the Father's throne? No, it's his throne. And his throne is a throne of what? Glory. And a throne identifies a kingdom. This is not the throne of grace identifying the kingdom of grace. This is the throne of glory identifying the kingdom of glory. All right? Christ's kingdom is the kingdom of glory. Christ right now is reigning with the Father in the kingdom of grace. But when you read 1 Corinthians 15, the Bible says that Christ gives all back to the Father, that the Father may become all in all. In other words, Christ gives back the kingdom of grace fully to the Father. And so now he can reign on his own throne, the throne that all through the Bible have been talked about. When you actually study about the throne of David, you ever read in Scripture how the Bible talks about how the throne of David would be established forever? You ever read about that? And that there would be one that would come and sit upon the throne of David that would last forever, and his kingdom would not pass to another? Who is the one that is to reign upon David's throne? It's Christ. But David's kingdom, if you read about David and his rulership over Judah and Israel, it was the time of glory. And so this throne is a throne of glory. As a matter of fact, Jesus himself talked about this in the book of Luke. Notice Luke chapter 1, last scripture. Luke chapter 1, and we're doing this to lay a little bit of a foundation for this afternoon. Luke chapter 1. Let's look together in verse 26. Luke chapter 1 and verse 26. As you study through the Old Testament, David's throne is called the throne of David, but it's also many times called the throne of the Lord. And you have to wonder, why is it called the throne of the Lord? It's because this is the throne of glory. Notice what it says. Luke chapter 1, beginning with verse 26. Are we all there? And in the sixth month, it says, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name what? Jesus. He shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father, who? David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there it shall be no end. This throne that is Christ's throne, not the Father's throne. This is the throne that is Jesus's only. This is the throne of glory. And when Christ comes, he sits upon the throne of glory. And he now issues in or ushers in the kingdom of glory. Are you with me? Now, with that in mind, let me read a statement that will kind of bridge some gaps in what we were talking about, as well as take us into this afternoon's presentation. This is Great Controversy 346, paragraph 4. Great Controversy 346, paragraph 4. I'm going to read to page 347, paragraph 2. It says, the announcement which had been made by the disciples in the name of the Lord was in every particular correct, and the events to which it pointed were even then taking place. The time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is at hand, had been their message. At the expiration of the time, the 69 weeks of Daniel 9, which were to extend to the Messiah, it says, at the end of the 69 weeks of Daniel 9, which were to extend to the Messiah, the anointed one, the Christ, had received the anointing of the Spirit after his baptism by John in Jordan. And the kingdom of God, which they had declared to be at hand, was established by the death of Christ. Now, we went through all of this in the Bible, so this is nothing new. This kingdom was not, as they had been taught to believe, an earthly empire. Nor was it that future immortal kingdom which shall be set up when the kingdom and dominion and greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High. That everlasting kingdom in which all dominions shall serve and obey him. Daniel 7:27. It wasn't that kingdom that Christ was establishing. As used in the Bible, the expression the kingdom of God is employed to designate both the kingdom of grace and the kingdom of glory. The kingdom of grace is brought to view by Paul in the epistle to the Hebrews, after pointing to Christ, the compassionate intercessor who is touched with the feeling of our infirmities. The apostle says, "Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace." The throne of grace represents the kingdom of grace, for the existence of a throne implies the existence of a kingdom. In many of his parables, Christ used the expression the kingdom of heaven to designate the work of divine grace upon the hearts of men. As a matter of fact, you read through all of Christ's parables and he says the kingdom of heaven is like unto what? The kingdom of heaven is like unto this. He was describing the kingdom of grace. So the throne of glory represents the kingdom of glory. And this kingdom is referred to in the Savior's words, when the Son of Man shall come in His glory, and all the holy angels with Him, then shall He sit upon the throne of His glory, and before Him shall be gathered all nations. This kingdom is yet future. It is not to be set up until the second advent of Christ. The kingdom of grace was instituted immediately after the fall of man, when a plan was devised for the redemption of the guilty race. It then existed in the purpose and by the promise of God, and through faith men could become its subjects. Yet it was not actually established until the death of Christ. Even after entering upon His earthly mission, the Savior, wearied with the stubbornness and ingratitude of men, might have drawn back from the sacrifice of Calvary. In Gethsemane, the cup of woe trembled in His hand. He might even then have wiped the blood sweat from His brow and have left the guilty race to perish in their iniquity. Had He done this, there can have been no redemption for fallen men. But when the Savior yielded up His life and with His expiring breath cried out, "It is finished," then the fulfillment of the plan of redemption was assured. The promise of salvation made to the sinful pair in Eden was ratified. The kingdom of grace, which had before existed by the promise of God, was then established. The spirit of prophecy, and it goes on, the spirit of prophecy clearly identifies a kingdom, two kingdoms and two thrones, one of grace, one of glory. And the kingdom of grace is that work which Christ desired to do, or He was destined to do. He was set in motion to do from the moment Adam ate the fruit. But you have to understand that that kingdom, we have to understand that sin was not an afterthought. Do you believe that? Hear what I'm saying. Not the plan for sin, but sin itself was not an afterthought. These things were planned for before man was created, before the first angel was created. Do you think that God the Father, in His infinite wisdom, did not understand that sin was inevitable? You read the first chapter of Desire of Ages, sin and the plan for sin was not an afterthought. Now you might, that might kind of blow your mind and say, well, wait a minute, you mean He knew all this time that that was going to happen? Well, brethren, in our finite understanding, we can't realize why God did what He did. But when my children ask me this question, I respond to them in this way. And those of us who are in parents in here can understand even better. And I believe that's the very reason why God put male and female and said, be fruitful and multiply, so that we can answer these myriad questions that come into our mind. How many of us, before we got married and before we desired children, knew that there was the possibility that there would be problems in the marriage, that there was a possibility that our children would be disobedient, that they could get sick, that they can get disease, that they could die, that bad things can happen? How many of us knew beforehand that this was a possibility? We all did, but we still did it. And why did we do it? We didn't have children so that we can make, you know, a little bit better when tax time came. We didn't have children and get married so that, you know, the benefits the world can give. We did it because that's the way you express love. You cannot express love when you're on your own. The only way love can be expressed is when there's others. And God, the Godhead, which is love, can express that and be that unless there are other beings made. So, brethren, sin was not an afterthought. These things were already understood before the first being was created, before Lucifer was made. First and the most beautiful being ever created was Lucifer. And it's very interesting, that was the one that issued it all in. But Jesus knew it. The Father knew it. And so, if you have that in mind, and you understand that in Revelation chapter 13, it says that Jesus was the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world, then in reality, the kingdom of grace, and I said the kingdom of grace didn't have to be, it didn't, because sin did not have to be. And the kingdom of grace, therefore, did not have to be. We could have went straight to the kingdom of glory, And the kingdom of glory is that the earth made new would house the new Jerusalem. That was God's desire from day one. He always wanted to relocate. God's desire was always that he would dwell with his people. That's the kingdom of glory. But because the kingdom of grace, because of sin, we can say that the kingdom of grace, well, that was from the beginning as well. Just when he created Lucifer, when he created the angels, when he created the other beings, and lastly created our planet, and us human beings, which were told in the spirit of prophecy, were a new and distinct order of being, that you and I were made in the image of God. Now, I don't know what that means for all the others, but we're told that we're new and we were distinct, made in God's image. Something, brethren, about what God, something about God's thoughts and his mind in creating this planet, I don't think I'll ever fully understand. I believe this will be my science and song for eternity, as well as yours. But brethren, in order for us to really get there and be participants in the kingdom of glory, we have to identify and understand and be a subject of the kingdom of grace. And we have to invite others to be a part of this kingdom as well. Because the kingdom of glory isn't until it's all done. The kingdom of grace was established when he said it is finished. The kingdom of glory is established when he says it is done. He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. He that is filthy, let him be filthy still. Both were established when it was finished, when it was done. So brethren, I hope that your eyes were enlightened a little. I pray that your understanding of things was expanded. And as we go into study this afternoon, we're going to talk about the three comings of Christ. Many of us don't understand there are three comings, and they're connected with the marriage. And this is appropriate because, as I said, your Sabbath school lessons on Revelation 19, where it talks about the two suppers, the supper of the lamb and the supper of the birds, or that eat the flesh of kings. And so we're going to talk about the marriage supper of the lamb. But before we get to the marriage supper, we have to deal with the marriage. And so we'll deal with that this afternoon. Amen? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we want to thank you, Lord, for our hour of study. We thank you, dear God, for your word. And we thank you, Lord, for the establishment of the kingdom of grace. All of the promises, all of the prophecies pointed forward to the literal lamb that needed to be slain. And we're thankful that he went through and did the work and completed his mission in saying it is finished. And he gave us the ability, the assurance, and the know-how that we can now come to the throne of grace and press home our petitions and find grace to help in time of need. We ask, dear God, that you would help us to remember these things and to understand that we can never be a subject of the kingdom of glory unless we first participate as subjects in the kingdom of grace. Help us, dear Father, to receive that grace ourselves and to invite others to be subjects of this graceful, beautiful kingdom. Guide us, Lord, and be with us. And may the kingdom of grace be established within us is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.